Yeah, so we will begin in a few seconds.
Okay, fine.
Thank you so much. Yellarigu namaskara. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us on this very important day, the World Water Day. This is a day that is held on 22nd March every year since 1993. It's a day that celebrates water and raises awareness of the 2.2 billion people living without access to safe water. This year's theme for the World Water Day is about valuing water. The value of water is much more than its price. Water has enormous and a very complex value and a very sacred value in every aspect of our life, of our daily life, in fact. So from our households to institutions, offices, hospitals, and for the production of everything that we consume, from food to all other utilities, water is very important. And yet we take it for granted. And in this context, if Bangalore and its sewers are any indication, it explains a lot. For Bangalore, water comes at a very great cost. The cost of pumping water up a 500 meter gradient and from over 100 kilometers away, or from the bore well several hundred feet below ground. Every drop of it comes with a huge carbon footprint. The Sustainable Development Goal 6 is to ensure water and sanitation for all. Without a comprehensive understanding of the water needs of the city, the demand and supply, we really will not be in a position to protect this vital resource and provide for the future as well. So it is in this context of global warming and climate change, water security is highly threatened. And in that sense, climate change challenges us to fully and truly understand the value of water. So on a day when the world dwells about the future of this only living planet, a planet filled with water, but with only about a percentage of it sustaining all of humanity and billion of other life forms as well, we are happy and proud that Brihat Bengaluru Mahanagarapalike Commissioner, Mr. N. Manjunath Prasad, has voluntarily committed to address climate change by working to meet targets of the Paris Climate Agreement. That is to take action at the local level that would help the world contain the global temperature rise to 1.5 degrees Celsius compared to pre-industrial levels. And this is truly unprecedented and calls for a better understanding of how Bengaluru will achieve this. While the city is grappling with struggles of water shortage, choked roads, poor air quality, loss of green cover, flooded streets, and poor quality of life for most of us, we are also seeing the expansion of the city, not just horizontally, but vertically as well. And the number of people who live in extremely poor conditions of housing has also increased phenomenally in this sprawling metropolis. So what steps will the city and its various agencies take to address this commitment? What measures will the BBMP take to raise awareness amongst its public? Will this be a time when ward committees can be made fully functional to ensure climate change starts at the ward level? And what will the actions be that people need to take at our own individual level to meet this goal and ensure Bengaluru becomes India's truly first climate-friendly metropolis? Bengaluru does have some systems in place with respect to rainwater harvesting, segregation of waste, carpooling, low-cost housing, alternate energy systems, and more. But these are very, very, very small and minute, and some are really tokenistic. And the last year, the pandemic has simply changed too much of the way we work and live. So in this new reality, this webinar series aims to discuss some of these critical questions and what possible actions can follow so we can move towards a more livable city that is also compliant with critically needed climate change actions. We are very happy to have with us today a panel of leading and amazing people who are the movers and shakers of Bengaluru. They are here today to share their thoughts with us so we can all collectively think to make Bengaluru India's first carbon neutral metropolis. So I'm very happy to have all our speakers. Again, thanks to each and every one of them. I'm also very happy to introduce each one of them very quickly. So we have Mr. Gaurav Gupta, who is the administrator of the BBMP. He's an officer of the IAS. He's been with the Karnataka government as additional chief secretary of commerce and industries with concurrent charge of administrator of BBMP in the past. He has also worked to create critical infrastructure such as transport, water, and electricity. And also for the state and for the city, he has served as chairman of the Bangalore Water Board and as a special commissioner in BBMP and managing director in KSRTC. Thank you, Mr. Gaurav Gupta. Welcome again. We also have Ms. Soumya Reddy, member of the Legislative Assembly. She's an elected member of the Legislative Assembly of Karnataka, also the current General Secretary of the All India Mahila Congress of Karnataka and a member of the Indian National Congress. She has a huge experience in grassroots activism and has worked for securing social and environmental justice. She was also conferred with the She Runs Government Award 2020 for the Best Outstanding MLA. Welcome, Soumya. Many, many thanks to you for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. And thanks for having us. And also thank you so much for this much needed conversation about the environment and climate change.
Thank you. Then we have Mr. B.R. Ravikanthi Gowda, Joint Commissioner of the Police Traffic Bangalore. Dr. Gowda is current Joint Commissioner and he has previously served as DSP, DCP, DIGP at numerous levels. In his academic career, he has received special recognition for his research work on Poet Laureate Sri Kuvempu. He is the recipient of the Chief Minister's Gold Medal twice. His concept of people-friendly policing has highly acclaimed and has been adopted throughout the state under government order. He had earlier participated in EST's webinar series, Better Bus Bengaluru, conducted in collaboration with the Bengaluru Moving to revitalize mobility in the city. Welcome, Mr. Ravikanthi Gowda. Tumba tumba dhanyavadagalu nam kade inda.
Namaskar, madam. Bala santosha.
Then we have Mr. Srinivasulu, IFS, Member Secretary, KSPCB. He's an officer of the 1997 batch. He's a current member secretary of the Karnataka Pollution Control Board. He has previously served as the chief conservator of forests of Shivamogga district. Namaskara, Srinivasulu avare, tumba dhanyavadagalu ee sabhe serkondiddakke. Then we have Ms. Anjali Dalmia, who's from the Yugma Network. She's a social environment and social activist, co-founder of the Yugma Network, which is the youth movement to work towards environmental justice through law, public participation campaigns, education and local languages, and the project Amara, which works towards sustainable menstruation across demographics and gender with a focus on urban slums and schools. She's also a member of the SAPAC, that is South Asia People's Action on Climate Change. Thank you, Ms. Anjali, for joining us on this very important webinar. So thanks everybody else for joining us and stay tuned every Monday for the next few weeks. So I would now request our first speaker, Mr. Gaurav Gupta, to share his thoughts on this very important topic. Over to you, Mr. Gaurav Gupta. Have we lost him?
Bhargavi, as he joins, I'll try to get him, but I just want to add a few comments for the webinar. Can I do it now or you want me
to? Sure, please.
Yeah, so I just wanted to, Bhargavi in our introductory remarks has really brought to fore the key questions that any metropolis has to grapple with when it evolves a plan as ambitious as this, which is to try and do our bit to ensure that climate change is reversed to the extent that the Earth reaches its stable situation climatologically. One of the key points that I want to highlight is this is a debate discussion which has been going on for decades. We have known certainly with great certainty actually that global warming has been happening since at least the 1960s. It was scientifically proven, but it took political action 30 years more. It was only in 1992 that in the city of Rio in Brazil, the Rio Declaration was agreed upon by all heads of governments. It's probably the only time heads of governments from all the countries met, with the exception, of course, of the United States. I remember senior George Bush was the president, and he sent Dan Quayle, his vice president, rather than himself turning up. In subsequent decades, we realized how America will renege on its global contract in terms of tackling climate change. Most critically, the way Donald Trump pulled out of the Paris Agreement. Thankfully, Biden is back with meeting his promise. The first decision he took was to rejoin the Paris Climate Agreement. But scientists are essentially saying that even with the Paris Agreement, we are unlikely to be able to reverse climate change because we have gone way far beyond what was even imagined scientifically. That said, the question really is this. We need to do our bit now, not tomorrow, not day after, and we should have done it like last decade. And the question is how. And for that, the 1992 Rio Declaration gives us a very simple prescription. And I'll just share my screen so that I can show you the Rio Declaration Principle 11, if you can see it here. I'm sorry, it's Principle 10. It simply says this. Environmental issues are best handled with participation of all concerned citizens. Now, I am assuming that UN meant all citizens are concerned, not only concerned citizens, at the relevant level. That's an important part because it's not that everything should be decided by the Prime Minister of India or the Chief Minister of a state. It has to be decided by the people, and that Prime Minister and Chief Minister should yield to people's will. And I'm sure people across the country are willing to agree that it is in everyone's interest now and into the future to reverse the climate shift that is taking place. And it also goes on to say at national level, each individual shall have appropriate access to information concerning the environment that is held by public authorities, including information on materials, activities in their communities, and opportunity to participate in decision-making processes. State shall facilitate and encourage public awareness and participation by making information widely available. Effective access to judicial and administrative proceedings, including redress and remedy, shall be provided. Now, when text like this has been signed on by heads of government and India came back and ratified it and we went on to pass a series of laws, what it really means is that climate action requires concerted effort between people and the government they appointed. And in a way that people are all the time able to shape the outcomes of decisions. So when Mr. Manjunath Prasad announced a few months ago that Bangalore is going to sign up on the climate agreement and the Paris Climate Agreement, and we will all do our bit to ensure that we can be the first metropolis in India to try and bring Bangalore to being carbon neutral. It's a very, very ambitious statement. I mean, given the state of affairs, there's a lot of hard work to be done. So the reason why we held this webinar series was, how can we help the commissioner? How can we help the administrator? How can we help the chief minister? How can we help our corporators and MLAs in ensuring, and how can we help each other in ensuring that this really happens? Because it's not just in our interests, it's critically in the interest of generations to come. They're going to blame us big time if we didn't get this right. And blame is not going to be very useful in future because what can they do to redress the damage we have done to them? So I think we should feel the sense of responsibility even a bit, not just a bit, but a good chunk of guilt, and take it upon ourselves to ensure that we will step up to this challenge, and we can, in a matter of years, if not months, substantially change the way the cities function. And this metropolis, which is now about 1.3, 1.5 crore population, is projected to reach 2.3 or 2.5 crore, and I hope it doesn't happen. We can also think of reorganizing how people live across the states, so cities like this should never happen. Megacities are bad news for the climate, and I hope that we can try and make it major cities and then micro cities perhaps, so that population disperses, energy consumed lowers, the carbon footprint comes down substantially, and we can all live happily ever after, like, you know, most movies can tell us, or most fables tell us. So I think it's really, this is an ambition to construct a fable out of a pretty dangerous place we are now in. So on that note, I thank again the panelists for having joined us today at short notice, and I thank all the participants. I want to say that this is the beginning of a 9-part webinar series, and the last one, we hope to invite the commissioner and also, if possible, the environment minister to listen to all the 7-8 themes that we would have debated. It will be every Monday at the same time, 6 to 7:30. We also think that this is a process which can be emulated by other cities across the country. And if the state and civic governments can work together with civil society organizations, I'm sure we can do incredible things. So on that note, I thank you all again, and I hand over and yield to Bhargavi.
Thank you, Leo, for setting that wonderful tone to today's topic. So I now request Mr. Gaurav Gupta to share his thoughts. I hope he's there.
I believe he has some internet issues. So maybe once the, resolve, they'll come back. I'll try to get him on the phone also.
Okay.
Yeah, I tried to log in into my phone because I'm having some issues, bandwidth issues. But let me see if I can join in again from the laptop itself.
Okay.
Why we wait for him? Should we request our next speaker to talk? I would now request Mr. Ravikanthi Gowda to share his thoughts while we wait for Mr. Gaurav Gupta. Mr. Ravikanthi Gowda,
yes. Namaskara. Ellarigu namaskara.
Heli.
Now, sannadrindlu. ಚಿಕ್ಕವರಾಗಿದ್ದಾಗಿಂದಲೂ ಈ ಪರಿಸರ ಈ ಪ್ರದೂಷಣೆ ಇತ್ಯಾದಿಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಬಹಳ ಆಲೋಚನೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಶಾಲಾ ದಿನಗಳಲ್ಲೂ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತಿದ್ವಿ. ಆದರೆ ಇದು ಈ ಪ್ಯಾರಿಸ್ ಒಪ್ಪಂದದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ನಿಗದಿತವಾದ ಒಂದು ಗುರಿಯನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟು ಕಳೆದ ಅರ್ಧ ದಶಕದಲ್ಲಿ 5 ವರ್ಷದಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಭೂಮಿಯನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸುವಂತಹ ಕೆಲಸವನ್ನು ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಮಾಡಬಹುದು ಅನ್ನೋದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಬಹಳ ನಿರ್ದಿಷ್ಟವಾದ ಗುರಿಗಳನ್ನ ಕೊಡಲಾಗಿದೆ. ಈ ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆ ಒಳಗಡೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಸಂಚಾರ ಪೊಲೀಸ್ ಅಧಿಕಾರಿಯಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಏನನ್ನ ಮಾಡಬಹುದು ಅಂತ ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ಅತ್ಯಂತ ಸಣ್ಣ ಸಣ್ಣ ನಮ್ಮ ಕ್ರಿಯೆಗಳು ಸಹ ಈ ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಎಮಿಷನ್ ಅನ್ನ ಇಂಗಾಲದ ಏನು ಹೊರಚಿಮ್ಮುವಿಕೆ ಇದೆ ಅದನ್ನ ತಡೆಗಟ್ಟುವುದರ ಮೂಲಕ ಈ ಪ್ಯಾರಿಸ್ ಒಪ್ಪಂದಕ್ಕೆ ನಮ್ಮದೇ ಆದ ಕೊಡುಗೆಯನ್ನ ಕೊಡುವುದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಅನ್ನುವುದನ್ನ ನಾನು ನನ್ನ ಕಳೆದ 1.5 ವರ್ಷಗಳ ಅನುಭವದಲ್ಲಿ ಕಂಡುಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೆ. ಈ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿದಾಗ ನಿಮಗೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಗೊತ್ತಿರುವ ಹಾಗೆ ಶೇಕಡ 60%ರಷ್ಟು ದ್ವಿಚಕ್ರ ವಾಹನಗಳಿದ್ದಾವೆ. 60%ಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ದ್ವಿಚಕ್ರ ವಾಹನಗಳಿದ್ದಾವೆ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ. ಇರತಕ್ಕಂತ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆ, ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟರ್ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆ ಸುಮಾರು 93 ಲಕ್ಷ ವಾಹನಗಳು. ಜನಸಂಖ್ಯೆ 1.3 ಕೋಟಿ ಇದೆ. 93 ಲಕ್ಷ ವಾಹನಗಳು ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಆದಂತಹ ವಾಹನಗಳು. ಕಳೆದ 3 ದಶಕಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆ 2 ಪಟ್ಟು 3 ಪಟ್ಟು 4 ಪಟ್ಟು 5 ಪಟ್ಟು ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಅದರಲ್ಲೂ ದ್ವಿಚಕ್ರ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗಿದೆ. ನಾವು ದ್ವಿಚಕ್ರ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆದ ಹಾಗೆ ಅನೇಕ ಕಾನೂನುಗಳನ್ನು ಜಾರಿಗೆ ತಂದಿದ್ದೇವೆ. 6 ತಿಂಗಳಿಗೊಂದ್ಸಾರಿ ಅವರು ತಮ್ಮ ವಾಯುಮಾಲಿನ್ಯ ಪ್ರಮಾಣ ಪತ್ರವನ್ನ ನಮ್ಮ ಮುಂದೆ ಸಲ್ಲಿಸಬೇಕು ಇತ್ಯಾದಿ ಇತ್ಯಾದಿ ಕಾನೂನುಗಳೆಲ್ಲ ಇದ್ದಾವೆ. ಆದರೂ ಸಹ ಅನೇಕ ಸಂದರ್ಭಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತೇವೆ, ನಾವು ವಾಯುಮಾಲಿನ್ಯ ಪ್ರಮಾಣ ಪತ್ರವನ್ನು ಪಡೆದಂತ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆ 1 ದಿವಸಕ್ಕೆ ಲೆಕ್ಕ ಹಾಕಿದ್ರೆ ಶೇಕಡ 50%ರಷ್ಟು ಇರಬಹುದು. ಇದು ಬಹಳ ಕನ್ಸರ್ವೇಟಿವ್ ಎಸ್ಟಿಮೇಷನ್. ಎಲ್ಲಾ ವಾಹನಗಳನ್ನು ನಾವು ಪರಿಶೀಲನೆ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ನಾವಂತೂ ಈಗ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ವಿಸಿಬಲ್ ವೈಲೇಷನ್ಸ್ ಇಲ್ಲದ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಮೇಲ್ನೋಟಕ್ಕೆ ಆತ ಸಂಚಾರ ನಿಯಮಗಳನ್ನು ಉಲ್ಲಂಘನೆ ಮಾಡಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಅಂತ ವಾಹನಗಳನ್ನು ತಡೆಗಟ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಇಂತಹ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ದಿನೇ ದಿನೇ ಹೆಚ್ಚಾಗ್ತಾ ಇರತಕ್ಕಂತ ಖಾಸಗಿ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಅದರಗಳ ಉಪಯೋಗ, ಏನೇ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳಿದ್ರು ಜನ ಖಾಸಗಿ ವಾಹನಗಳಿಗೆ ಮರೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಇರುವುದನ್ನ ಗಮನಿಸಿದಾಗ ನನಗೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಸಂಚಾರ ಪೊಲೀಸ್ ಅಧಿಕಾರಿಯಾಗಿ ಅನಿಸ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು ಏನಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ನಾವು ಈ ಸಾರ್ವಜನಿಕ ಸಾರಿಗೆಯನ್ನ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಪೋರ್ಟ್ ಅನ್ನ ನಮ್ಮ ನೀತಿಯನ್ನಾಗಿ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದರೆ ಮುಂದಿನ ದಿವಸಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ಯಾರಿಸ್ ಒಪ್ಪಂದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಬದ್ಧರಾಗಿದ್ದೇವೆ ಅನ್ನುವ ಭರವಸೆಯನ್ನ ಕೊಟ್ಟು ಏನ್ ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ ಅದು ನಿಜಕ್ಕೂ ಸಾಕ್ಷಾತ್ಕಾರಗೊಳ್ಳೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ. ಯಾಕಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ನಾನು ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಹೇಳಿದಾಗೆ ಅನೇಕ ಖಾಸಗಿ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಬಳಕೆದಾರರು ಅವರು ಬಳಸ್ತಾ ಇರತಕ್ಕ ಸಂದರ್ಭಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ತಮ್ಮ ಜೀವನೋಪಾಯಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಈ ಖಾಸಗಿ ವಾಹನಗಳನ್ನು ಬಳಸುವವರ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ 90%. ಇನ್ನು 10% ಹತ್ತಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಜನ ತಮ್ಮ ಸುಖಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಅಥವಾ ಸುಖ ಸಾರಿಗೆಗಾಗಿ ಈ ವಾಹನಗಳನ್ನ ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಈ 90% ಜನ ಅವರಿಗೆ ನಿಜವಾಗ್ಲೂ ನಾವು ಸಾರ್ವಜನಿಕ ಸಾರಿಗೆಯನ್ನ ಬಹಳ ಉಪಯುಕ್ತವಾಗಿ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಟ್ರೆ ಸಾರ್ವಜನಿಕ ಸಾರಿಗೆಯನ್ನು ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸ್ತಾರ ಅವರು, ಅವರಿಗೆ ಉಪಯುಕ್ತವಾಗುವುದಾದ್ರೆ ಸಾರ್ವಜನಿಕ ಸಾರಿಗೆಗೆ ಅವರು ಬದಲಾವಣೆಯನ್ನ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ತಯಾರಾಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸಾರ್ವಜನಿಕ ಸಾರಿಗೆಯನ್ನ ನಾವು ಎಲ್ಲಿ ತನಕ ಒಂದು ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿಯಾಗಿ ರೂಪಿಸುವುದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯವಾಗುವುದಿಲ್ವೋ ಅಲ್ಲಿಯ ತನಕ ಒಬ್ಬ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿಗನಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಪ್ಯಾರಿಸ್ ಅಗ್ರಿಮೆಂಟ್ಗೆ ನನ್ನ ಬದ್ಧತೆ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳೋದು ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗ್ತದೆ. ಇದು ನಾನು ಕಂಡುಕೊಂಡಂತಹ ಸತ್ಯ. ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಏನು ಉಪಕ್ರಮಗಳನ್ನು ಕೈಗೊಳ್ಳಬೇಕು, ಯಾವ ರೀತಿಯ ಕ್ರಮಗಳನ್ನು ಕೈಗೊಳ್ಳಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವುದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಈ ಸಾರಿಗೆ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಪೋರ್ಟ್ ವಿಭಾಗದಲ್ಲಿ ಬಹಳ ಅನುಭವವುಳ್ಳಂತಹ ತಮ್ಮ ಅಗಾಧ ಒಂದು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥವ್ರು ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಎರಡನೆಯದು, ನಾನು ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಅನೇಕ ವಾಹನ ದಟ್ಟಣೆಗಳನ್ನ ದಿವಸ ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತಾರೆ, ಅದು ಪೀಕ್ ಅವರ್ಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಥವಾ ಲೀನ್ ಅವರ್ಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲೂ ವಾಹನ ದಟ್ಟಣೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ವಾಹನ ದಟ್ಟಣೆ ಆಗೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಕಾರಣ ಏನು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ಮೊದಲನೇದಾಗಿ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ರೋಡ್ ಇಂಜಿನಿಯರಿಂಗ್ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ಸ್, ರಸ್ತೆ ತಾಂತ್ರಿಕ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳು. ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ರಸ್ತೆ ಬಹಳ ದೊಡ್ಡದಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ, ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ಕಿರಿದಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ, ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ಬಾಟಲ್ ನೆಕ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ಇಂಥ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಬಹಳ ಸಹಜವಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ಸಣ್ಣ ತೊಡಕು ಕೂಡ ದೊಡ್ಡ ವಾಹನ ದಟ್ಟಣೆಯಾಗಿ ರೂಪುಗೊಳ್ಳುತ್ತದೆ. ಈ ವಾಹನ ದಟ್ಟಣೆಯಾಗಿ ರೂಪುಗೊಳ್ತಕ್ಕಂತ ಇಂತಹ ರೋಡ್ ಇಂಜಿನಿಯರಿಂಗ್ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ನಾವು ಗಮನ ಹರಿಸಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ. ಈ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಈ ನಗರಗಳನ್ನ ರೂಪಿಸ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಪ್ಲಾನ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಇಂಜಿನಿಯರ್ಸ್, ತಾಂತ್ರಿಕ ಯಾರು ಅನುಭವ ಉಳ್ಳವರು ತಂತ್ರಜ್ಞರು ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ. ಎರಡನೆಯದು, ನಾನು ಹೇಳಿದ ಬಹಳ ಸಣ್ಣ ಪುಟ್ಟ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳನ್ನ ನಾವು ನಿವಾರಣೆ ಮಾಡುವುದರ ಮೂಲಕ ಈ ಪ್ರದೂಷಣೆಯನ್ನ ತಡೆಗಟ್ಟಬಹುದು ಅಂತ ನಾನು ಭಾವಿಸಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ಉದಾಹರಣೆಗೆ, ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಬಹಳ ಸಣ್ಣ ವಿಚಾರ ಅನಿಸ್ಬಹುದು, ಈ ನೀವು ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನ ಸರ್ಕಲ್ಗಳನ್ನ ನೋಡಿರ್ಬೋದು. ಈ ಸರ್ಕಲ್ಗಳ ಸಮೀಪದಲ್ಲೇ ಒಂದು ಬಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಇರ್ತದೆ, ಆ ಸರ್ಕಲ್ಗಳ ಸಮೀಪದಲ್ಲೇ ವಾಹನ ನಿಲುಗಡೆ ಇರ್ತದೆ, ವಾಹನ ಪಾರ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಇರ್ತದೆ. ಇವು ಆ ವಾಹನಗಳು ಆ ಸರ್ಕಲ್ನಿಂದ ದಾಟಿದ ಮೇಲೂ ಸಹ ಸರ್ಕಲ್ನಿಂದ ಆಚೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಂತಹ ವೃತ್ತದಿಂದ ಆಚೆ ಹೋಗದಂತಹ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿಯನ್ನು ನಿರ್ಮಾಣ ಮಾಡ್ತವೆ ಮತ್ತು ಆಯಾ ಸರ್ಕಲ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಕಾಲ ವಾಹನಗಳು ನಿಲ್ಲುವ ಮೂಲಕ ನಮ್ಮ ಪರಿಸರದ ಮೇಲೆ ಆಗ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಏನು ಒಂದು ಆಘಾತ ಇದೆ ಅದು ಪ್ರತಿ ದಿವಸ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಹೋಗ್ತದೆ. ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಗೊತ್ತಿರುವ ಹಾಗೆ ಬಸ್ ಬೇಗಳ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆ ಬಹಳ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಇದೆ, ಬಸ್ ನಿಲ್ದಾಣಗಳೆಲ್ಲ ರಸ್ತೆಯ ಮೇಲೆ ಇದ್ದಾವೆ. ಇವುಗಳೆಲ್ಲವನ್ನ ನಾವು ಬಹಳ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಇನ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಬೇಕಾಗಿಲ್ಲ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ. ಇದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲವನ್ನ ಸಣ್ಣ ಪುಟ್ಟ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳನ್ನ ಸರಿ ಮಾಡುವುದರ ಮೂಲಕ, ಮೈಕ್ರೋ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಇದನ್ನು ಮಾಡುವುದರ ಮೂಲಕ ದೊಡ್ಡ ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರಿ ಏನಿದೆ ಪ್ಯಾರಿಸ್ ಒಪ್ಪಂದ ಆ ಕಡೆಗೆ ಹೆಜ್ಜೆ ಇಡಬಹುದು ಅಂತ ನಾನು ಅನ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ಅದೇ ರೀತಿ ಈ ಪರಿಸರದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥವ್ರು ತಮ್ಮದೇ ದ್ವೀಪಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ದ್ವೀಪಗಳನ್ನ ತಮ್ಮದೇ ಐಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಸ್ನ ಸೃಷ್ಟಿ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಕುಳಿತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಂತ ನಾನು ಅಂದ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ನನ್ನ ಅನುಭವ ಅದು. ಉದಾಹರಣೆಗೆ ಕೆಲವರು ಇದನ್ನ ಯಾರು ಅನ್ಯತಾ ಭಾವನೆ ಮಾಡಬಾರ್ದು. ನನಗೆ ಬಂದು ಕಬ್ಬನ್ ಪಾರ್ಕ್ ಮೂಲಕ ವಾಹನಗಳನ್ನ ಬಿಡಬಾರ್ದು, ಅದರಿಂದಾಗಿ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಪರಿಸರದ ಮೇಲೆ ದುಷ್ಪರಿಣಾಮ ಬೀರುತ್ತದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದಾಗ ನಾನು ಕೂಡ ಅದು ಸತ್ಯ ಇರಬಹುದು ಅಂತ ಅನ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೆ. ಆದರೆ ಅನೇಕ ಪರಿಸರ ತಜ್ಞರ ಜೊತೆ ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಿ ಚರ್ಚೆ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ಅವರ ಅನುಭವದ ಆಧಾರದ ಮೇಲೆ ಹೇಳಿದಾದ್ರೆ ಅದು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಪರಿಸರದ ಮೇಲೆ ಪ್ರತಿಕೂಲ ಪರಿಣಾಮವನ್ನು ಬೀರುತ್ತದೆ ಎನ್ನುವುದನ್ನು ಅವರು ತಮ್ಮ ಅಧ್ಯಯನದ ಮೂಲಕ ನನಗೆ ತೋರಿಸಿಕೊಟ್ರು. ನಾವು ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಇಂಥ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳನ್ನು ನೋಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥವ್ರು ಆಳಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗದೆ, ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಯ ಆಳಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗದೆ ಕೇವಲ ಮೇಲ್ಪದರದಲ್ಲಿ ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡುವುದರಿಂದ ಪರಿಸರದ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳ ನಿವಾರಣೆಯ ಉಪಾಯಗಳೇನಿದ್ದಾವೆ ಆ ನಿವಾರಣೆಯ ಉಪಾಯಗಳು ನಿಜವಾದ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳನ್ನು ಬಗೆಹರಿಸುವುದಕ್ಕೆ ಕೆಲವು ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ ಅನ್ನುವುದು ನನ್ನ ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯ. ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಈಗ ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಕೂಡ ನಾವು ಪರಿಸರದ ದೃಷ್ಟಿಯಿಂದ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ವಾಹನಗಳನ್ನು ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವ ಒಂದು ಏನು ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಇದೆ ಅದನ್ನ ಖಂಡಿತ ಮುಂದುವರಿಸಬೇಕು. ಆದರೆ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ವಾಹನಗಳು ರಸ್ತೆಗಳಿಗೆ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇರತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಈ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಅವುಗಳಿಗೆ ಒಂದು ಪರ್ಯಾಯವಾದ ಕಾನೂನನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ನಾವು ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ವಾಹನಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋಗ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥವ್ರು ಅಪಘಾತಗಳಿಗೆ ಈಡಾದರೆ, ಉಲ್ಲಂಘನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಅವರನ್ನ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಮೋಟರ್ ವೆಹಿಕಲ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್ ಇದರ ಒಳಗಡೆ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ನಾವು ಫಿಟ್ ಇನ್ ಮಾಡಬಹುದು, ತರಬಹುದು, ಅದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಕೂಡ ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಈ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಚರ್ಚೆ ಆಗ್ಬೇಕು. ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಇವತ್ತು ನಿಜವಾಗ್ಲೂ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನ ರಸ್ತೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಸೈಕಲ್ ಸವಾರರಿಗೆ, ಪಾದಚಾರಿಗಳಿಗೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಅವಕಾಶವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿಕೊಡ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೇವೆ. ಆದರೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಅಪಾಯದಲ್ಲಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥವ್ರು ಕೂಡ ಅವರೇ. ಹೀಗಾಗಿ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ವಾಹನ ಬಳಕೆದಾರರು ಕೂಡ ಮುಂದೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ರಸ್ತೆಗಳ ಮೇಲೆ ಅಪಾಯಕ್ಕೆ ಒಳಗಾಗುವ, ರಸ್ತೆ ಅಪಘಾತಗಳಿಗೆ ಒಳಗಾಗುವ ಸಾಧ್ಯತೆಗಳಿರ್ತವೆ. ಈ ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆ ಒಳಗಡೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಸುರಕ್ಷತೆಯನ್ನ ಕೊಟ್ಟರೆ, ಸೈಕಲ್ ಬಳಕೆದಾರರಿರಬಹುದು, ಪಾದಚಾರಿಗಳಿರಬಹುದು, ಅಥವಾ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಬಳಕೆದಾರರಿರಬಹುದು, ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಸುರಕ್ಷತೆಯನ್ನು ಒದಗಿಸ್ತಕ್ಕಂತ ಒಂದು ರಸ್ತೆಯ ಸುರಕ್ಷತಾ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿಯನ್ನ ನಾವು ಬಿತ್ತಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ. ಇದನ್ನ ಮಾಡಿದಂಥ ಪಕ್ಷದಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಬಳಕೆದಾರರು ಹೆಚ್ಚಾಗಿ ಈ ಪರಿಸರದ ಮೇಲೆ ಆಗ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ದುಷ್ಪರಿಣಾಮ ಕೂಡ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಅಂತ ನಾನು ಭಾವಿಸಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ಎಲ್ಲದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಏನು ನಾವು ರಸ್ತೆ ಬಳಕೆದಾರರಿದ್ದೇವೆ, ವಾಹನಗಳ ಚಾಲಕರಿದ್ದೇವೆ, ಅದು ದ್ವಿಚಕ್ರ ವಾಹನ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ನಾಲ್ಕು ಚಕ್ರ ವಾಹನ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಭಾರಿ ವಾಹನಗಳಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಆ ವಾಹನಗಳ ಬಳಕೆದಾರರಿದ್ದೇವೆ, ನಮ್ಮ ರೋಡ್ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ರಸ್ತೆ ಮೇಲೆ ನಾವು ರಸ್ತೆಗಳನ್ನು ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಒಂದು ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಏನಿದೆ, ಕ್ರಮ ಏನಿದೆ, ಅದು ಬಹಳ ಸುಧಾರಿಸಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ. ಈ ಬಗ್ಗೆಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಗಮನ ಹರಿಸಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ನಾನು ಈ ಒಂದು ವಿಚಾರ ಸಂಕಿರಣವನ್ನ ವೆಬಿನಾರ್ ಮೂಲಕ ನೀವೇನು ಆಯೋಜನೆ ಮಾಡಿದಿರಿ ನಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರ ಕಣ್ಣನ್ನು ತೆರೆಸ್ತದೆ ಅಂತ ಅನ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ಹೊಸ ಹೊಸ ಆಲೋಚನಾ ಕ್ರಮಗಳಿಗೆ ನಾವು ತೆರೆದುಕೊಳ್ತೇವೆ ಅಂತ ಅನ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ನಿಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಮತ್ತೊಮ್ಮೆ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಗಳು. ನನ್ನ ಆಲೋಚನೆಗಳನ್ನ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಜೊತೆ ಹಂಚಿಕೊಳ್ಳೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಅವಕಾಶ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಡೋದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ.
ತುಂಬಾ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಆಲೋಚನೆಗಳನ್ನ ನಮ್ಮೊಂದಿಗೆ ಹಂಚಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಕ್ಕೆ. ನಾನೀಗ ಲಿಯೋ ಸೆಲ್ಡನ್ ಅವ್ರನ್ನ
ನಿಮ್ಮ ಧ್ವನಿ ಕೇಳಿಸ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ.
ಇವಾಗ ಕೇಳಿಸ್ತಾ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಅನ್ಸುತ್ತೆ. ನೀವು ಹಂಚ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದ ಆಲೋಚನೆಗಳನ್ನ ಲಿಯೋ ಸೆಲ್ಡನ್ ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ಒಂದ್ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅನುವಾದ ಮಾಡಿ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಹೇಳೋ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ರಿಕ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂತೀನಿ.
ಎರಡೇ ನಿಮಿಷದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾಡ್ತೇನೆ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರವಿಕಾಂತ ಕೋಟ್ರೆ, ತುಂಬಾ ಒಂದು ಬ್ರೆಡ್ತ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡೆಪ್ತ್ ಆಫ್ ಯುವರ್ ಕವರೇಜ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಇಶ್ಯೂಸ್ ಯು ಕವರ್ಡ್ is difficult to translate, but I'm only going to give highlights of it because we have an audience which is beyond Bangalore. Dr. Gowda highlighted how at least half the vehicles in Bangalore pollute.
Yeah, but
the difficulty is how to regulate it. And there is an increasing reliance on private vehicles. And with this type of a movement towards private travel, we are unlikely to meet Paris Agreement targets. He said, public transport needs to be our culture. Unless it becomes a culture, he said, he is unlikely to see the city meet the Paris Agreement targets. And he also called on public transport officers to pitch in and push forward the idea of making public transport a culture. Then he shifted to the point that we cannot have less pollution and less carbon emitted from all of this activity on the roads of a metropolis if our road engineering problems persist. And he highlighted something as ordinary as road design. Sometimes very wide roads collapse into bottlenecks and a small hindrance can lead to a pileup. All this adds up to climate change because the amount of carbon that is dumped in the atmosphere due to traffic jams like this. So you highlighted the importance of micromanagement. Then he went on to also call upon environmentalists to get out of islands because there is no synergy between different types of environmental arguments. And he highlighted how, for instance, the example of trying to make Cobham Park traffic free has become a very popular demand. But he says the views are divided and there are scientific views which show that if that happens, there could be a net increase in carbon emissions. So how does one get around these complex issues with solutions? And he felt that that requires a deeper reflection. He also went on to highlight, for instance, the move towards electric vehicles. He said that's a great move, but is the Motor Vehicles Act amended to accommodate for their presence on the streets? And he said they are the most vulnerable vehicles on the streets today. And therefore, unless we think of street redesign and accommodation of these vehicles and cycles and so on, it might actually be a dangerous idea to promote them. So this is one of the other complexities he highlighted, that at the planning, at the operational level, city managers and people like him face. But all said and done, he is very positive that with the type of conversations we are now having, this webinar opens our eyes to these type of issues and concerns. And perhaps that's the process in which we can try and find solutions. I hope I've done justice to your presentation.
Saldanavare,
heli sir.
Eshtu chennagi neevu adanna English nalli brief maadi helidire andre neevu election time alli yaradaru rajkaranigalu sikkitre nimmanna karkondu hogi alli vedike milisi translator aagi ittkonbidtaru.
Avaru kariyodu beda sir, nannu antha public bitte sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Oh, bala bala chennagi maadidre. Thank you.
Thank you sir.
ಸರ್ ಲಿಯೋ ಸಲ್ದಾನಾ ಸರ್ ಅವರೇ ಎಲೆಕ್ಷನ್ ನಿಂತ್ಕೋಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ನಮ್ಮ ಕೋರಿಕೆ ಸರ್.
ಇಲ್ಲ ಮೇಡಮ್, ಹೌದು ಹೌದು ಖಂಡಿತ
ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರುಗಳು ಸರ್.
ಇಲ್ಲ, ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಗುರುಗಳು ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಶಿಷ್ಯ ಮೇಡಮ್.
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಲಿಯೋ ಫಾರ್ ದಟ್ ವಂಡರ್ಫುಲ್ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಲೇಷನ್. ಐ ನೌ ರಿಕ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ ಮಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಗೌರವ್ ಗುಪ್ತಾ ಟು ಶೇರ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಥಾಟ್ಸ್. ಓವರ್ ಟು ಯು ಮಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಗುಪ್ತಾ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.
ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್ ಈವ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಅಂಡ್ I thank environment support group led by Mr. Leo Saldana. We all heard his communication skills right now. He is a excellent communicator, and I'm sure that the group under his leadership would be able to drive the public discussion that is being organized as a part of this discussions in the next 7 days or so. So my thanks to all the panelists, and as regards the Bangalore climate action commitments and what it takes, the panel discussions being organized as a part of the discussions on the subject, and the objective is, I believe, to look into issues, concerns, and how we can meet the Paris Climate Agreement demands, as have been communicated in the letter by the commissioner to the chair of C40 cities. This was a letter, I believe, written in August 2018 or so, around that time. And as we know, Paris Climate Agreement says basically to make every participating entity to take local action that would help the world to contain the global temperature rise to 1.5 degrees Celsius as compared to the pre-industrial levels. Now, Bangalore, as a result of this communication and this interaction, and is one of the members of the C40 cities. The C40 cities network basically connects the city practitioners and mayors across the world to enable collective action to be taken up for climate change. And I'm sure that if 40 cities get together, they work together, and they share experiences together, in that case, they would be far more impact on the global efforts towards climate change. This would enable the city's collective power to be channelized and used further. Now, as regards the issues that are important for containing climate change, we know that it relates to basically urban transport planning. Now, we had Mr. Ravi Kantegowda talked about certain issues of transportation and traffic. Urban transport, we often see it as a reactive kind of thing, there's a problem and we try to react to it. But what is required is that we should have a proper, proactive transport planning. And beside the urban transport planning, we should also be going into the issue of managing waste, managing air quality, better energy management in buildings, and such other things. Now, I am told that London and Bangalore are the city leads in respect of air quality network. This air quality network, which was taken up in 2018, involves measuring and monitoring of air quality, health impact analysis, and measures to take up policy implementation. So this air quality network, there was a conference and a workshop which was organized by our city through the BBMP in 2018, in which the delegates from various countries participated and finalized a report, which I have also tried to do some kind of study. But it basically laid down the broad principles on how we can take a few things forward. Environment cities, environment issues in a city like Bangalore are very, very vital. Not only we require development, but we also require to ensure environmental sustainability. In the recent past, we have had Honorable Chief Minister launching the Mission 2022 program, in which a number of measures have been identified to conserve ecology and environment, and also to protect water bodies, and also to promote green parks, etc. in the city. 25 lakes, I am listing out some of the measures which have been identified, and we are taking it up with all the stakeholders. We know that Mr. Ravi Kantegowda just now explained about the traffic issues. We have Mr. Srinivasulu, the State Pollution Control Board Member Secretary, who will talk about several other issues. And Mrs. Swamya Reddy, I'm sure she will also touch on various issues, etc. So now I am listing out some of the issues which have been identified, and we are working on it from the Bangalore Mahanagar Palike. 25 lakes are being taken up for rejuvenation in the next 12 months. Taken up, and it is underway. It is being reviewed regularly. The ambient air quality monitoring programs have been proposed recently, and I'm sure Mr. Srinivasulu will mention more of it. This would be part of our ambient air quality improvement measures. Measuring stations is also a part of it, but also not only measuring stations, but how we can have mitigation. So that is also there. There are different measures which are being taken up as a part of this. Greening of urban spaces is one of the third points which I would like to highlight, and a special drive for tree plantation. Now, this is being taken up. The numbers are being taken up. A number of 10 lakhs has been indicated for tree plantation in this year. And traffic engineering measures have been taken up that include lane discipline, bus base formation, and also footpath improvement. So we need to encourage non-motorized modes of city of commuting in the city. So whether it be cycling or whether it be footpath improvement, etc. So those are important issues. Also, public transport, as also has been told, that we need to promote public transport and also the bus bays, etc. Now, mega tree parks are being taken up by the Forest Department at various locations. Some of them are in the public domain, so we know about them. I leave it to their judgment which one to be taken up, in what manner to take them up, etc. There are experts who know how the tree parks have been taken up. Various very good examples have come up in the past. JP Park of Mathikere will be taken up further by the BBMP, including the water body improvement. Kabban Park is also being taken up under the smart city projects for giving it a new facelift. Kormangla Valley, the development of Kormangla Valley under the, as a part of the citizen waterway project, is being taken up. Metro lines have been identified for quick completion. Especially we are trying to target where the felt demand is far more as compared to the existing capacity, particularly the Whitefield line and the Electronic City line, where the traffic congestion is severe. Suburban rail projects have been taken up in four corridors. All the suburban rail projects will also complement the metro and also provide the much needed public transport. And as you know, all these public transport are electricity driven. So therefore it will also lead to less congestion and less air pollution in the city. Bus priority lanes are being taken up as a part of the high density corridors. Some of it has already been included in the all the high density corridors. So we are also taking up bus priority lanes depending on the width of the corridor. Now, electric vehicles are being promoted as a part of the electric vehicle policy of the state. Mr. Ravi Kantegowda talked about some of these issues. A very important part of this is that there should be not only the improvement on production, improvement on manufacturing, but also improvement in demand. And also there should be public charging infrastructure. So this public charging infrastructure is being taken up in 1,000 points in the city. Already we have close to around 140 points, but we would like to step it up. And this effort is being driven by BESCOM, another government entity, which is the public utility in respect of electricity distribution. Now, water harvesting and water recycling, these are important parts of not only environment conservation, but also they are part of our building bylaws. Bangalore was one of the first cities in which the water harvesting was made compulsory as a part of the building bylaws, and several efforts are being taken up on this regard. So we welcome the public discussion initiated by the environment support group, and in this week-long consultative exercise, I'm sure that more and more proposals will come in from the public, from the common citizens, and also the experts and leaders. And we look forward to inputs from all of the citizens so as to identify priorities and also to take up all these measures to make environmentally sustainable development in the city. So with this, I would like to conclude. I wish all the best for the initiative taken by Mr. Leo Saldana. And I'm sure that Bangalore, being one of the very environmentally conscious city, we have seen tremendous public involvement in all the green related issues. I have personally inspected number of lakes and parks, and I know that there are a number of civic groups that are working closely on the issues so as to ensure not only the proper development, but also maintenance and upkeep of these facilities. So I'm sure that this kind of public consciousness is very, very necessary. We have a very public aware citizenry in the city of Bangalore, and look forward to all of this happening in the days to come. Thank you all very much, and look forward to outcomes. And I would request the organizers with us so that we can benefit from the feedback that has been obtained. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gupta, for highlighting all the many initiatives that have been taken up by BBMP as part of this commitment. I hope you will continue to stay with us and take some of the questions that will come towards the end of all the talks that our speakers will share. So we would now move on to our next speaker, who is Mr. Srinivasulu. I request Mr. Srinivasulu to kindly share his thoughts.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Hope I'm audible.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you for giving me this opportunity. First of all, Paris Convention immediately brings me some nostalgic moments, because it is in that COP summit where Honorable Prime Minister released a CD, Shanti Samsara, that he handed over to French President. And incidentally, I have the small role in that documentary where some of my works were included in that Shanti Samsara documentary. That apart, coming back to this important issue, it's very nice, like Bangalore being such a city where a lot of these things can be experimented, tried, everything. And KSPCB is seriously committed to the commitment of the country that made in COP21 summit. KSPCB in particular, when Gaurav Gupta was explaining about the various actions that we are doing, I would like to put them in three files. Like, what is the real activities that board is doing now in three ways? One is application of technology in addressing the waste management issues, number one. Number two is awareness. Okay, this becomes very high important that what we are doing. The third is, in fact, maybe a bit controversial, but then I try to dare it here. Like, how Saab mentioned about the carbon park, where misplaced priorities, because pollution, environment is one subject where, looking by different prisms, people can get to different conclusions. We need to look at a holistic picture. Otherwise, we will be doing more damage in the process of doing something good to environment. Now, coming to technology, number one, Bangalore being the Silicon City tech center of the country, then it is high time that we use technology to address our issues. Board is committed to that. In that, number one, recently if you are seeing, it's very surprising where there are nearly some 100 vehicles that transport so-called hazardous waste from generator to different processing plants. And for reasons best known to many, it was not tackled, but no, last 2 months back, what we did was we brought all these vehicles, and by putting a GPS and then the API ID is there in my website. Everybody can watch the movement of these transporting vehicles that carry hazardous waste crisscross Bangalore, so that the issues of V Valley dumping, all those things are addressed properly. Number one. Number two, in fact, the data management is very important. All said and done, when this waste management is moving from generator to transporter to processor to end user, we need to stitch these together to track it so that our implementation and our enforcement will be proper. In that respect, again, we have brought out a technology of e-manifest system, which April 1st, Honorable Minister will be launching. So that then at our fingertips, we will know, who is generating, where it is moving, where it is disposing, so that, it can be managed and then it can be monitored properly. The third is, recently, you all may be aware, like KSPCB, we have launched our mobile app. This is one, because today, technology mobile app is how powerful tool. We try to use that powerful tool to drive home the issues of, environment pollution across public. Where now anybody can get into all the activities, rules, regulations, infrastructure, everything of pollution control board by just downloading a mobile app from the Play Store, KSPCB. Okay. Now, for common man, it is present at present, it is very important for him to know what is the quality of air he is breathing and what is the quality of lake water that is nearby his house or locality. Now, these two important documents, either two, which was ocean of data was there in the board. Now it has been culled out into simple API parameters and then it is put in that mobile app. Now anybody at any point of time can get access to the quality of air that he is breathing and the quality of water that, lake that is here, in and around him through this mobile app. Now, engagement with public becomes very important. So in that respect, you might be knowing recently we have come out with integrated control and command center. There is one number, 2558-2559. Anybody can reach board at one number and then that will raise a ticket and then that will move to different people who are responsible people and then that will be taken care of. Now, Gaurav Gupta Saab was mentioning about CIQM stations. Yes, Saab has helped us a lot in now. In fact, if I am telling, Bangalore has the highest density of air quality monitoring stations anywhere in the country. So that, what is our air quality, we will be able to monitor. In fact, I'm happy to share all said done, and maybe 50 API is good, but our API is 87. But then this 87, we have brought down from 120 to 87, where we are doing a better job and then our air quality is better. Still, we can go a long way. Like this, application of technology, we can do in a long way in board management. Number two, awareness. In fact, this is one sector where a lot needs to be done because all said and done, when public are aware, when public start debating the issues of pollution, debate will result into some policies. Policies get into programs. When there are programs, government comes out with budget and then this will be implemented. So it should start. And I'm happy that this forum, that what we are doing is a part of that, bringing in awareness about issues of pollution and public across members. In this respect, board is doing a lot of things. People who are listening to radio off late, for last 3 months, board is going to public with themes. Like January, our theme was solid waste management. 20 different speakers spoke on that issue throughout month. February was all our sewage issues. So now every month I'm going with some one theme and bringing out officers and then experts, domain experts, so that people start discussing about these issues and then come back to people that what is the problem, what is the solution, where is the gap, and then how it can be addressed. So that's how we are trying to bring in more awareness. In fact, I should thank Bangalore citizens because they are so aware about environment issues. Recently, now in last year, when we see this 2020 Ganesha festival, every time Ganesha festival becomes a big water pollution issues, and then we board came out with a small simple solution or some simple thought of turmeric Ganesha, Arishana Ganapa, and it caught the imagination of the public, and then 2020 Ganesha festival was the best Ganesha festival where the damage that our generally lakes used to happen was reduced considerably, and I'm sure this will be emulated subsequently also. Similarly, in fact, in Deepavali festival also, in fact, this time we really drove green pataki, and all said and done. People sometimes say because of COVID kind of a thing, but then COVID is not just only for Bangalore, COVID is there for whole country. So when we look at the across different states, what is the air quality before Deepavali, during Deepavali, and then Bangalore stands much above many cities, where the awareness campaign of the board and goodwill of the people club together, and then we were able to address or contain air pollution to a large extent, and then it was a successful example by campaign as such. Then third is maybe, you know, I would like to put some issues here, like misplaced priorities. Friends, environment is one issue or one sector, unlike any machine kind of a thing, where you know anything, everything, matlab isko kiya kya hoga, usko kiya kya hoga. Environment is not like that. It's a living entity having, you know, different life forms, different interactions. Some are complementary, supplementary kind of a thing, reaction. So unless we look at that, it is very difficult to jump to some conclusions and line of treatment. Like lake management. In fact, I use this forum to bring in some thoughts here. We all take pride in lake management. Yes, okay. Recently, some small incident happened. Somebody came to me saying that, sir, we are, you know, government is very kind enough to sanction some budget for lake management, lake development, and we are doing that. I told, very good. What are you doing? Have you seen the project kind of a thing? He started explaining me in lake development what all they are doing. One is desilting, good, you know, bund, good, fencing, chain link, you know, footpath, vegetation, some lighting, board, everything. Yes, good, I told. The total budget was something around 25 crores. I simply asked one question. Yes, all are good. But lake essentially means water. Now, where is your intervention to address the issues of water that is reaching the lake? Somewhere it is missing. Okay. Sometimes we get driven by civil engineering type of works to address our ecological issues. Okay. We need to be cautious here, because now when sewage is the biggest threat to the lake, now first point of our intervention should have been, from where sewage is coming, why sewage is coming, if sewage is coming, how I can treat it, how I can avoid sewage entering lake. Okay. And then if I'm able to treat it, and then treat it and send so that, you know, it becomes, you know, normal. Now, a simple STP to treat sewage doesn't cost more than 3-4 crores. But when the budget is 25 crores, your first intervention should have been STP, but then it doesn't happen. But so this is a misplaced priorities. We need to address this properly so that the money that we are spending is in right direction, and then the problem we want to address is understood properly, and then we make it, you know, a real solution. Second is, you know, we look about this pollution. In fact, among different pollutions, we talk of solid, and then we talk of liquid, we talk of air, all said and done. But then water pollution becomes the number one, you know, issue, that if it is not addressed properly, it can have serious consequences. Friends, today, we all know, many of us know, every day we generate around 3,550 million liters of sewage. Every day I'm talking. Now, out of this 3,550 million liters, how much I am, you know, really treating? What is my competence? What is my capability? And then what is my, you know, installed capability, and what is my operational capability? The pride we take in getting fresh water to Bangalore, in fact, we should be taking more pride in increasing our capability of treating sewage, because fresh water, once it is used, immediately, next minute it is sewage. Okay. So the sewage treatment capabilities, you know, we need to take pride in increasing its capabilities. Right now, out of 3,550 million liters, we are able to hardly treat around 1,800 million liters. So there is a big gap, and this gap is damaging exponentially our lives. Okay. It is not plus, it is exponentially. Okay. In fact, this is resulting in 17 identified polluted river stretches in Karnataka. In fact, when I was discussing with students somewhere here and there, generally we think, no, Ganga nama papagalanna tolitale anta, Ganga hamare paap dhoti hai. Well, if you just take it in real sense, water will treat our pollution. Okay. But then today, if we are having polluted river stretches, the capacity or capability of Ganga to, you know, to clean up our evils or paap dhone ka uski capacity, you know, we have exhausted it. So you know, it is high time that we take sewage treatment systems, whatever it is. We have enough opportunities. Matlab today I'm happy Gaurav Gupta sahab is here. We all take pride in saying that, you know, BWSSB treated sewage water is pumped to fill nearly 150 lakes in Kolar and Kolar and this area, and then that groundwater is recharged there. Now, what else is a better example than this, where the water, treated water, is a resource which can change our lives. Water is not a commodity. Water is life. Life starts here, thrives on here, and even it disappears here. So this kind of a sense, if we are able to address, and then I'm sure we have big solutions. Then third irony is people are talking about Kabban Park Forest. Yes, okay. Now, forest has to be understood in its whole entity. In fact, if I take 2 minutes, I would like to take 2 minutes to, you know, to tell importance of forest here, because being from forest department, I might be tempted to do that. Just yesterday, I was addressing some webinar where value of forest. See, we all know forest is valued as the value of trees in that forest. Matlab teak hai to bahut zyada hai, rosewood hai to bahut zyada valuable hai. Forget about trees and valuable trees, timber. Let's simply take waste forest, something like Raichur or Gangavati area. We all know in 1960s, 50 or 70 years back, we were drought prone country, and then there was food shortage. And then something happened. What is that? Green Revolution, right, which gave us food. What I'll just take finish into 1 minute. Green Revolution. And now, what is Green Revolution? Green Revolution is high yielding wheat varieties became dwarf wheat varieties and then gave us food. Fine. How did it all become dwarf? Scientists did. How did they do? Did they just do some magic? No. They brought some dwarf gene that is there in unnoticed forest to our domestic varieties. That dwarf gene, which was there unnoticed in forest as a dwarf grass living for thousands of years, has no economical value. But when we had some problem, when we transferred that gene to my variety, it became of immense economic value. Today, if for last 50 years, if the gene has fed 1.3 billion people for 50 years, had anybody put royalty to that gene, can you imagine what is its economic value? You can't even calculate it. So that's the value of a forest, because genes, ecosystems, evolutionary, these things, they cannot be simply valued in monetary terms. That is where we need to really understand the value of forest, because solution is in nature. Today, whatever we want, tomorrow we can go back to forest and then find solutions. We can go back to nature and find solutions, because so that is how we should understand, and then we should try to appreciate it in its entirety, so that we will be able to take the best use of those things. And these are some of the things that board is trying to implement, educate, and then involve public in pollution management and environment. And these are few thoughts that I just wanted to share before the August body. Thank you for giving me this opportunity, and then I will seriously look forward for more and more engagement with everybody to address this issue. Thank you one and all.
Thank you Mr. Srinivasulu, for your wonderful thoughts on a wide-ranging list of topics. I now request Soumya Reddy to share her thoughts. Over to you, Soumya.
Can you hear me?
yeah we can hear.
Okay, so English and matadla kannada matadla yav I assume that there are other people from other states as well, so is it okay to talk in English? I'm just taking permission before I speak.
I think English would be better because it is reaching a wider audience. In case there are people who need a translation in Kannada, one of us will do that. Thank you.
Okay, great. So really want to thank ESG for this much needed conversation and discussion. I really want to thank all the dignitaries as well who have spoken earlier, Bhargavi, Leo, and of course everyone, Srinivas Guru sir, Gaurav Gupta sir, and I think Ravikante Gowda sir, and many others as well. And I don't want to take up too much time, and because I don't want to repeat what others have said as well. But I just want to kind of, I know I'm wearing a politician's hat right now, but I'm also an environmental engineer and studied energy and environmental management as well. So I'm extremely passionate about this. So I was actually very, very thrilled when Bangalore, especially BBMP, committed recently to the Paris Agreement. One of the things that I have been, I've grown up as talking about environment and protesting as well. In fact, I worked with, Leo, Bhargavi, and many of you. And, even when I did my master's in the United States, in fact, I still remember we actually spoke about, 2 degrees. This was more than 10 years ago. And we're still talking about 2 degrees right now. And I don't want to talk about the details about, the Paris Agreement. Yeah, but one of the few things that I really want to touch upon and maybe play a little bit of a devil's advocate or a bit of a reality check is, of course, I want to really kind of congratulate and say kudos, to BBMP, including our, administrator, of course, Srinivas Lusa. I've worked with him as well, and they're doing wonderful work. And of course, our commissioner. So I think one of the things that we really need to focus on is that, reducing the emissions of, greenhouse gases, talking about Bangalore in general. I think if we really want to be carbon neutral by 2050, how is that we're going to realistically work on that and make sure that's really possible? I think if we're really committing, or if we have committed to that already, I think we really need to kind of like talk about like what is right now, what's the situation, and also how, and of course work backwards. So I want to talk about a few things, that I just made a note of. One thing is we need to focus on, we need to work on not just, our own city, but I think we need to have a updated action plan on climate change for our own state of Karnataka. And many of us have had these discussions, there have been many reports, there have been many organizations and nonprofit organizations who also spoken about it. I've also been a part of it as well. I think a few things that we need to focus on is currently, of course, the greenhouse emissions and what are the main sources. And talking about specifically, what is the inventory? It could be, power, transport, households, industry, agriculture, and of course, allied sectors, and waste, solid waste management. And I think we also need to kind of focus on the vulnerability, as in like, we tend to talk about, there are a lot of natural disasters that's happening, which is very much connected to climate change. But I think we're thinking about things, we're not talking about all of them with respect to climate change. And of course, I think one of the things that we also need to focus on is main things is forests, biodiversity, wildlife, and also we need to focus on energy as well, urbanization, and also the people who are being affected by climate change. So having said that, I just want to talk about, I don't want to repeat what others have said, but a few things that I want to talk about is, of course, carbon tax, and also the environmental footprint of you know, things, including everything at from a city point of view. And I mean, the thing is, one of the main things is, I mean, preserving the existing greenery, including the forests, is something that's like just so important. That is, I mean, I'll give you a few examples of how things have probably kind of gone wrong. It's really nice for us to talk about climate change and, you know, signing the Paris Agreement. But on in reality, if we are doing things which is contrary to that, then it just doesn't make sense. For example, all of us know what happened to the Hubli-Ankola Railway exactly a year ago at the State Wildlife Board. You know, all of us, I was one of the board members as well, and even though we disagreed to it, you know, the state government and many other members bulldozed it and passed it. And and that is something that we really, I mean, the Western Ghats is something that we really need to preserve. Talking about a few other things as well, for example, the Turhali forest. We know what happened also recently. I mean, it's great that we want to do tree parks, but why destroy an existing a forest that's there already and make it into a park? So I think, and another one is also the Hesargatta Lake. I think the grasslands is also something that we need to work on. And instead of just, I mean, we're talking about Mission Bengaluru 2020, and but I think I frankly, as an environmental engineer and also a person who has worked in this field, I feel it's kind of, I don't really see much crux to the whole thing where we can actually realistically kind of, you know, for example, existing tree cover. I can see that the trees that are there within the city are also continue to be indiscriminately, you know, chopped down for no reason. And I think that is something all of us need to work on as well. In fact, there is supposed to be a tree survey that's supposed to happen. In fact, I spoke about this in the previous meeting as well, which was called by Gupta sir and also the commissioner. And because, and another thing is also the lakes. All of you have spoken about lakes. I don't want to talk and repeat about all the lakes. I think one of the biggest impacts that we have had, especially with respect to climate change in our own city and state, is I would say the recent floods and also drought in North Karnataka, be it in Kodagu, and also of course in Bangalore itself, it's happened, and which has also happened in the neighboring states as well, be it Kerala. I mean, we think about very interesting things that we need for the city, of course. I mean, ours is one of the biggest cities, and it's growing day by day. And but at the same time, if we have things like Tender Shore, you know, like an entire patch of huge, massive trees were chopped down. And it's just being put by shrubs. So I think things like these really need to, you know, be worked on. And even ward committees, one of the most beautiful things that actually come thanks to, in fact, the civil society and many of you is also, it's been, was implemented in the past couple of years, is the ward committee. I think, because of the 74th amendment, instead of the things, us doing things, top to bottom, it has to be bottom to top. And so be it solid waste management, be it, you know, greenery, be it even looking at doing a tree survey and anything, be it lakes. And of course, I also want to talk about sustainable mobility and public transportation, which is something that we need to focus on extensively. Whenever, I mean, I'm sure all of us have traveled abroad. You know, it's much better to use public transportation than use, you know, a cab. Why not do that in our own cities as well? So I think we need to start focusing on, of course, you know, cycling, make it more pedestrian friendly, and also make sure it is all of these things are inclusive and progressive at the same time. For example, when you're talking about solid waste management, why is that? I mean, we're constantly talking about waste to energy. We need to also include stakeholders like waste pickers as well. I mean, and of course, Bangalore's had the most amazing civil society, which has been a part of all these things, be it solid waste management since 17th of December, thanks to, you know, the High Court, segregation has been made mandatory. In fact, we've gone up to 95% in some wards. In fact, we got an award as well. I myself went to Berlin last year. We got an award called as Better Together Award for, you know, composting the entire waste, working with citizens, you know, with other collaborators like Carbon Masters and everything. But I think and this has to be focused locally. Why can't we do this at a ward level, at a constituency level? We're still sending waste, 100 kilometers away, 70 kilometers away, and we are still incentivizing waste, mixed waste. You know, that they, when that us, sending the waste far away. So I think we need to start focusing on all of that. And of course, I've spoken about lakes already. And also, I think rejuvenation of Raj Kalwe's and many other things. I think I'll just stop for now because I think many others also want to say, and there are people who are also giving a lot of questions. But I think I want to just end it by saying that I think we need to act, locally, think globally. Which I know it's very old saying, but I think there is a need for that right now. Because at the end of the day, be it clean water, air, environment, each and everything, we're not doing it for the environment. We're doing it for us. We're doing it for the generations way ahead. So, there have been articles as well saying that Bangalore is going to also have really bad water problems as well. So I'll just stop for now. So once again, thank you so much for putting this wonderful, much needed panel. And I'll just let somebody else talk for now.
Thank you. Thank you, Soumya, for highlighting some of the very crucial issues that Bangalore today is struggling with. I'm sure we'll get a lot more questions on those specific issues. We will now move on to our last speaker, Anjali Dalmia, who's been patiently waiting. Over to you, Anjali, and looking forward to hearing your thoughts because you represent the next generation, the youth of our country. So over to you.
Thank you so much. And thank you very much to all of the speakers, and thank you for having me. Of course, I've learned a lot from listening to everyone who has spoken before, and many points and new initiatives which are being taken up, which are very heartening to see that are happening. I will not repeat, of course, some of the infrastructural changes that have been suggested and some of the action points that have been suggested. Instead, I was thinking of talking more about how every... is my video not visible? It is visible. Okay, great. So I was thinking about talking more about how every city is shaped by also behavioral changes. So behavior shapes the cityscape and how the city is actually managed and the different infrastructural projects which come up in a city. And so how does this impact the youth? And there are a few different points that I wanted to raise. First is regarding education. So to begin with, if we look at education and the amount of one urban environment that actually features in our educational syllabus, as well as education about the environment and ecology in general. But more specifically looking at, of course, there needs to be an improvement in the curriculum, a change in the curriculum to include more ecology in a more holistic manner. But along with that, also more hands-on activities, like for example, every child in school taking care of a plant on their own or having their own little garden bed, whether it is in school or at their house, and learning how to grow their own food. Or for example, if it is combining with civil society groups to go for tree plantations or wastage, understanding where your waste comes from. These could be great activities for young people in schools to engage with and learn more about their ecosystem in their city. So that was one point over here. And to tie to this, I think this comes very well with education, is also more awareness of, so we learn, like I learned also many things today listening to all of the experienced speakers. Having more of these talks and more engagement between young people and the, for example, the BBMP and the other institutions as well in Bangalore, so that young people have more dialogue and have more understanding of where do their resources come from, what kind of measures are being taken up in the city, what kind of initiatives are being planned in the city. And that way they can not only learn, but wherever they have, would like to give feedback or would like to get involved, they would be able to do that as well. So I think understanding our local governance, we do focus on governance and civics, for example, but actually looking at the hyper-local and understanding how our local corporations and such institutions work could be a great addition in educational system curriculums. And to add to this regarding adding to the municipal cooperation, I think, or the BBMP interaction and other institutional interactions could even be simple things like, for example, ward committee meetings occur regularly. So young people attending these ward committee meetings, which are open to all citizens, and just listening or understanding and contributing where they would like. So making more of these accessible and more public, either through social media or just publicizing them, I think could encourage more young people to also join. And of course, this has to be an initiative both from the youth as well as from the institutions itself. Besides this, of course, there's been talk on public transport today. And so I am actually a resident of Pune, and the time that I spent in Bangalore, I realized something that was actually Bangalore is a wonderful city to walk in. And not living in Bangalore, living in a city where walking is a lot more difficult or cycling is a lot more difficult, I actually realized that Bangalore can, you can actually walk and travel in Bangalore much more easily. There is much more public transport that is well connected and well maintained as well. So encouraging more young people to use the public transport and walk. So explore the city by walking. Not only will they, that will reduce carbon emissions, but it will also help the young people connect to their city more and understand some of the issues in the city more. There's also things like ULUs or cycling and having an app or a separate, more easily accessible schedule and map for buses, for example. I think youth are very drawn to technology and it's very easy for us to use it. So having more of these things through easily accessible technology, I think will really encourage young people to actually use public transport. That is one more part. And the third point that I wanted to address is finding or encouraging more interesting and better modes of entertainment for young people. So a lot of young people like going and hanging out in malls or in other such spaces, which of course have large carbon emissions, and are also not very, they don't expose young people to any new forms of thought or any new forms of engagement or connection to the areas around us. So having more interesting forms of entertainment, more community spaces and non-commercialized community spaces where young people can get together for more culture, for more art, and for more community service. and places beyond just some of the large parks in Bangalore, although I would say that is wonderful that those exist. Many cities do not even have that, but I think to go even beyond that and create open common spaces where young people can interact and learn and get out of, I think, the digital world a little bit to see what's actually happening. So these are some of the points which I wanted to raise. And of course, along with this, all of the wonderful infrastructural changes, technology changes, and ecological preservation that all the speakers have mentioned before me. So I wanted to add this part from I'll just address, I think rather than more entertainment, what I meant is a different form of entertainment. Entertainment or art, culture is always part of one's life. So I think youth engagement in being active citizens and also to find a more sustainable and better modes of transport and daily living would really create a behavioral change, I think, which would lead to a more sustainable city. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Anjali. And it was wonderful listening to you, and especially your point on interesting forms of non-commercial entertainment, making community service accessible, and the non-mall experience, which is so much related to the carbon emissions. So thanks everyone for all your thoughts. We do have some questions, and I would request you all to stay on for a few more minutes so that we could take some questions. There are a series of comments that have come in where most people have appreciated this forum and this initiative. There's one comment that I would like all our speakers to listen to, which says that please could we somehow be able to individually connect with the various speakers in the days to come to engage with them and offer individual ideas and suggestions more effectively. So if there are email IDs or other forums where people can give you the suggestions, please let us know and we will communicate it, put it in the chat box. And I'm sure the process can be made more participatory and inclusive, which is the essence of this entire webinar series. There are a couple of questions addressed to some of our speakers. I would now like one particular question addressed to Mr. Ravikanthi Gowda. So Shamla Kitane says that while we are looking at carbon footprints and understanding the life cycle assessment, especially of metros versus the carrying capacity, so would the BRT system and cycling infrastructure in Bangalore bring about some kind of mitigation towards climate change? And she also asks if subsidies for buying electric vehicles will motivate people to buy and use them. ರವಿಕಾಂತಿ ಗೌಡ ಅವರೇ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ
ಖಂಡಿತ ಅವರು ಏನು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದಾರೆ, ಖಂಡಿತವಾಗಿ ಸೈಕ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಮತ್ತೆ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ವೆಹಿಕಲ್ಸ್ ಮತ್ತೆ ಡೆಡಿಕೇಟೆಡ್ ಬಸ್ ಲೇನ್ಸ್ ಏನಿದೆ ಖಂಡಿತವಾಗಿ ಇದು ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಎಮಿಷನ್ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆ ಏನಿದೆ ಇದನ್ನ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಬಹಳ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಕಾಣಿಕೆಯನ್ನು ಕೊಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಇದೆ. ಆದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು ನಾನು ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಹೇಳಿದಾಗೆ ನಮ್ಮ ರೋಡ್ ಯೂಸರ್ಸು ಮತ್ತೆ ಡ್ರೈವರ್ಸು ರೈಡರ್ಸ್ ಇವ್ರದ್ದು ಕಲ್ಚರ್ ಬದಲಾವಣೆ ಆಗ್ದೇನೆ ಇವರು ಯಾರು ಸುರಕ್ಷಿತವಾಗಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಬೈಸಿಕಲ್ ಸವಾರರು ಅಥವಾ ನಮ್ಮ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ವೆಹಿಕಲ್ಸ್ನ ಯಾರು ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸೋಕೆ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ ಅವರ ಸುರಕ್ಷತೆಯನ್ನ ಪ್ರದಾನ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಳ್ದೇನೆ ನಾವು ಬಿಟ್ಟರೆ ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ಅನವಶ್ಯಕವಾಗಿ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿಗೆ ತೊಂದರೆಗೆ ಅವರ ಪ್ರಾಣಾಪಾಯಕ್ಕೆ ನೂಕದಾಗಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ ನನ್ನ ಅನುಭವ. ಇವತ್ತು ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಾಗಲಿ ಅಥವಾ ಬೇರೆ ಇಡೀ ಭಾರತದ ಯಾವುದೇ ನಗರದಲ್ಲಾಗಲಿ ಸೈಕಲ್ ಸವಾರ ತಾನು ಧೈರ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಹೋಗಬಲ್ಲೆ, ನನಗೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಸೈಕಲ್ ಸವಾರ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಅಲ್ಲ ಪಾದಚಾರಿ ಧೈರ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಹೋಗಬಲ್ಲೆ ಅನ್ನುವ ಒಂದು ವಾತಾವರಣ ನಿರ್ಮಾಣ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಹಾಗಾದಾಗ ಅವ್ರು ಹೇಳಿದಾಗೆ ಈ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗೆ ಒಂದು ಪರಿಹಾರ ಇದೆ. ಎರಡನೆಯದು ನಾನು ಮತ್ತೆ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಸಲಹೆ ಅವ್ರದ್ದು ನೀವು ಮಾತನಾಡಿದ್ರಿ, ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದ ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ವೆಹಿಕಲ್ಸ್ ಸಬ್ಸಿಡಿ ಬಗ್ಗೆ. ಸಬ್ಸಿಡಿ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಖಂಡಿತ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ವೆಹಿಕಲ್ಸ್ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗಬೇಕು, ಆದರೆ ಅಟ್ ದ ಸೇಮ್ ಟೈಮ್ ವಿ ಶುಡ್ ಎನ್ಶೂರ್ ದಟ್ ದೀಸ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಆರ್ ಸೇಫ್ ಆನ್ ಅವರ್ ರೋಡ್ಸ್. ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್. ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ very, very important. Then only people will come forward to use all these vehicles, electrical vehicles, bicycles on our roads. Definitely it will mitigate the problem.
There's one more question to you by Mr. Mysore Mart, and he says, why not put an embargo on registration of the second vehicle in a family for 2 years? Do you think it would be possible?
ಇದು ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟಿಕಲ್ ಆಗಿದೆಯಾ ನೋಡ್ಬೇಕು ಶ್ರೀ ಮೈಸೂರು ಮಠ ಅವರೇ. ಯಾಕಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಈಗ ಏನಾಗಿದೆ, ಒಂದು ಎಲ್ಲರದು ಒಂದು ರೆವಿನ್ಯೂ ಕಲೆಕ್ಷನ್, ವೆದರ್ ಗವರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಅಫೋರ್ಡ್ ಟು ಡೂ ಇಟ್, ಅದು ಬಹಳ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಮಟ್ಟದಲ್ಲಿ ನಿರ್ಧಾರ ಆಗ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಸರ್ಕಾರದ ಮಟ್ಟದಲ್ಲಿ. ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಸೌಮ್ಯರೆಡ್ಡಿ ಅವರು ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಶಾಸಕಿ, ಅವರು ಉತ್ತರ ಕೊಡ್ಬೇಕು. ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಬಹಳ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಪಾಲಿಸಿ ಡಿಸಿಷನ್. ಎರಡನೇ ವಾಹನವನ್ನ ಯಾವುದೇ ಒಂದು ಕುಟುಂಬದ ಒಳಗಡೆ ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ರಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಷನ್ ಇರಬೇಕು, ಅದನ್ನ ಕೊಂಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದಕ್ಕೆ ರಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಷನ್ ಇರಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ. ಆ ರೀತಿ ಮಾಡುವುದು ಒಂದು ಒಟ್ಟು ಕೈಗಾರಿಕಾ ನೀತಿಯ ಒಳಗಡೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯನಾ ಸಾಧುನ ಅನ್ನೋದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಯೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಇದರ ಹೊರತಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಈ ಸಲಹೆ ಪರವಾಗಿದ್ದೀನಿ. ಐ ಆಮ್ ಇನ್ ಫೇವರ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸಜೆಷನ್, ಪ್ರೊವೈಡೆಡ್ ದ ಗವರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ should change or thinking of changing its policy on this matter.
Mr. Mysore Mart avare, ivaru Gaurav Gupta avaru horadbekante, so I would request him to share some of his thoughts because he stayed through and listened to all of us. So it'll be wonderful to listen to your thoughts, Mr. Gaurav Gupta.
ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ. ಬಹಳ ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಸಂವಾದ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ಎಕ್ಸಲೆಂಟ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕಷನ್ ವಿಚ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನ್ಡ್, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ಲಿ ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಡಿಲೈಟೆಡ್ ಟು ಹಿಯರ್ ದ ಯಂಗ್ ಮಿಸಸ್ ಅಂಜಲಿ ಡಾಲ್ಮಿಯಾ. ಶಿ ಸ್ಪೋಕ್ ವೆರಿ ವೆಲ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಾಟ್ ವಿ ನೀಡ್ ಟು ಡೂ ಫರ್ದರ್ ಇಸ್ ಟು ಸಿ ದಟ್ ಹೌ ಯಂಗ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಡಿಸೈಡ್ ಟು ಅಡಾಪ್ಟ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಎನ್ವೈರನ್ಮೆಂಟಲಿ ಸಸ್ಟೈನೇಬಲ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಫ್ಯೂಚರ್. So if I'm sure that all of you are very well conscious and aware from the beginning in your schools, colleges, in your groups, etc. So if that is done, it will help. For example, it could be issue of using less water. It should be it could be issues of like, for example, walk where you can walk at least for half a kilometer, 1 kilometer. You can walk and reach, or any other modes of transport which appeal to you. So it's for the city planners and city managers to see that we are able to give you choices. The choices should be made available, and that is what we are doing by ensuring public transport is not just buses, but also metro, but also suburban rail. Also, we ensure pedestrian safety. We ensure cyclist safety. And such others. We also promote electric vehicles again to see that the internal combustion engines, which is a major source of pollutants, etc., comes down. Now, I would also like to compliment Mr. Srinivasulu, who spoke excellently on the issue of water recycling. One of the very, very effective reuse of cycled water, recycled water, has been done in the state of Karnataka. More than 400 MLD of water is going to Kolar and a number of other neighboring districts, and it is leading to recharge of groundwater. And most of the water engineers and water practitioners know that if we allow the water to flow in the open with oxidation, etc., after 30-40 kilometers of run, it will rejuvenate itself and it will become pure, and that is what is being done. So that is in my experience one of the largest such things being taken up, not only for agriculture but also by industries. Also, tertiary treated water is being taken up. We all know Bangalore is on the plateau, and it takes a lot of energy for water to come in by pumping over 1,000 feet over 100 kilometers. And I think that's a very important step to be taken. Likewise, online monitoring of sewage treatment plants in the private residential complexes is a very important task to be taken up. If we are able to ensure that every housing society is and their sewage treatment plants are running effectively, in that case, it will enable less of discharge in the waterways of the city. And that will obviously lead to much reduced water pollution. So these issues are there. There are larger issues on air quality and how we can have more sustainable growth, how we can have more plantation, etc. So these issues are critical. And I would say that we should try to create consciousness in each of our wards. A beautiful suggestion came up from Mrs. Soumya Reddy about how to engage the ward committees even more. I have participated in a number of ward committees, and what I see is that ward committees are the wards themselves are a big, large area and with large population, almost 40 to 50,000 population. And area-wise also substantially large. There are certain privileged neighborhoods, certain not so privileged neighborhoods. And if we start from ward as a unit, in that case, it can become a movement, whether it is for better waste collection or better civic amenities or better upkeep of public spaces, etc. So this is what is required. So I appeal to all of you, kindly try to see how your ward committees function. Several of them are functioning very well. Some of them, there may be definitely room for improvement. I keep on getting feedback from citizens about it. And they say that they would like to participate more in the ward committees. And I would strongly implore them to do so. So let us all work together. It's an excellent initiative. And at the government level, at the top level in BBMP, we are all committed to it. Mahanagar Palike is for the people of Bangalore, and I'm sure that more and more things would happen in the days to come with active citizen participation. So I'll conclude it here. Thank you all very much, and look forward to meeting you sometime again, and look forward also to receiving the feedback from the organizers. Thank you, Mr. Leo Saldana and Mrs. Bhargavi Rao. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I have one suggestion if Sir Gauragupta sir is still there?
Yes.
Sure.
Sir, under your leadership, if you could just call for a meeting, there will be so many people, non-profit organizations, including ESG, and many interested elected representatives, and of course, citizens will be happy to come and be a part of this. So I please request you, under your leadership, to call about this specific thing for BBMP, because it's something that's much needed, and all of us are willing to work together towards this goal.
Sure, we will definitely, I will interact with you one-to-one and try to understand how we can make it possible. And we do require some network of people. And I would say we require a federated kind of structure in which there are organizations, there are societies, there are groups, etc. And they federate to the city level. And the city level, then there are people who can, speak on their behalf. And this kind of structure would be necessary for a big city. We are also looking at, it may be good to share that we are looking at how we can have decentralized system of administration, decentralized system of planning, and also finance and other management, so that more and more responsibility is given down to the lower level. And that will include even zones, or it may be constituency oblique division level, or even ward committee level. We are working in that direction, and you will shortly get to hear from us on that. Thank you.
Bhargavi, I just want to share one thing, Mr. Gupta.
Sure.
That soon after this session is over, our colleagues are putting together notes, and within an hour, we'll have a report ready. The idea is that each of these discussions will lead to the next one. So what Soumya suggested, we will be supporting that exercise with this exercise. So this is really an idea of opening up the discussion towards creating a plan which is people friendly, because people made it. where people like you work from within the system and people like us work from outside the government system. But together we are the system.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good evening, all of you. I'm sorry I have to leave, but it was wonderful being with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for joining.
Thank you, Mr. Gaurav Gupta, and thank you, Soumya, for your suggestion and the fact that Mr. Gupta agreed to it, and we'll all look forward to it. I know time is like we've passed time, but just a couple of more questions. So there are a couple of questions to Ms. Soumya Reddy, and these are particularly in the context of waste. So there is a question on the whole waste to energy plant that will only make the system more slack in the context of segregation. So if one is planning these kind of things, we will only be going in the Okhla way, like in Delhi. So waste to energy is just a toxic problem, is what Shyamala Kitane says. And then she also asks that apart from preserving existing greenery, we should immediately scrap carbon intensive and arbitrary projects like white topping of roads. So would you like to comment on this? Soumya?
Sure. I mean, I completely agree. I mean, waste to energy is something that is, it doesn't really incentivize segregation. We are working towards segregation right now. And then, but when you're actually saying that you're going to happen, open waste to energy plants, then people are going to say like, okay, listen, why should we segregate anymore? And also, of course, I mean, we also need to really look into the impact of the toxins from these waste to energy plants as well. I mean, this has happened in other countries, and I think we need to stop glorifying them. And I have been definitely one of those people who have been disagreeing with having waste to energy plants. I'm not saying that we are going to have 100% segregation overnight, but I think we need to start incentivizing, people who are segregating. There are still places where, there has to be complete end to end, right from houses to where your garbage is picked up. There are still people who complain, who say that, as soon as I segregate my waste, but they mix it when they come and take it. And this is the most common thing. But so I think we need to start focusing. For example, in my own constituency, we did like a small pilot for a while and just like worked on one ward, Zero Waste JP Nagra, where we connected with the entire network of citizens who started focusing on segregation. And they did lane composting. They were segregating in their own houses. In fact, even during COVID, when there were a bit of issues, when there were black spots in many places, in that particular place, it didn't affect at all because we already had a good system working over there. And I think the BBMP also needs to have focus, do special focus on solid waste management as well. I mean, if you're going to increase segregation, there's going to be more dry waste that's going to come out. Each and every ward is supposed to have a dry waste collection center. As of now, that's not there right now. And another thing is also, focusing on composting. Okay, fine, you're going to get compost. Let's start incentivizing people. I mean, let's give the compost, to farmers. And I think they're also going to start compost Sundays, which is a great thing. This was happening years ago when our government was there. And having said that, there was another, we also passed the plastic ban years ago in 2017, basically, aping the West. Almost half the disposables were, half the garbage was full of disposables, be it plastic bags, thermocol, plastic spoons, you name it. But I think right now we need to start working on implementation of the plastic ban, also stopping the manufacturing of that. And I think yes, white topping. Yes, I think this is something that needs to be worked on as well. They say that it lasts longer, but I frankly don't know the impact environmentally. They also say that it has an impact on percolation of water to aquifers and stuff like that. Yes, of course, the governments need to have a look into that. I hope I answered all the questions.
Yeah, thank you so much. And we've really crossed the time, but
can I just quickly add something?
Sure.
I think electric vehicles, I think safety is important, of course. I'm not saying that safety is not important. Pedestrian safety, and of course, cycling. A whole year I cycled, and I think women who are also pedestrians, cyclists, it also needs to be safe for them. And also my first vehicle car was an electric car. I used an E2O for years. So I think the government, maybe the central government and the state government, needs to start incentivizing, two-wheelers, cars, and have a policy of that as well. It's still very expensive. I think electric vehicles, the cheapest one is probably about 8 lakhs. And I saw another one recently, which is about 23 lakhs. And so I think, having cycling lanes and everything, we've had these conversations before, but it just kind of fizzles down after a period of time. I think if we genuinely start having getting people together. We have the good fortune of having a very vibrant, dynamic civil society. So I think we need to start working with them and start implementing and also taking their suggestions and also making sure that only their suggestions are implemented.
Thank you. Thank you, Soumya. And
Thanks.
I thank everybody who joined us, and I would like to acknowledge a special guest in the audience, Dr. Nagendran, who has been our lecturer, mentor, professor for a long time, and he was also the scientific member at the NGT, and happy to have him here at this forum, and we look forward to his continuous engagement in these kind of dialogues, because his voice matters a lot. So thanks, everyone. Stay tuned for the Monday webinars for the next 7 weeks. And we would love to engage with you more, and do share your thoughts and suggestions, and we will ensure it will move into some kind of an action. And we also request you all to pass on the word that EST is open for internships, volunteers, and many other ways in which all of you would like to engage on this particular issue. We could be more creative and do a bunch of very interesting things to ensure we meet this particular target. Thank you, and have a good evening.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Gowda, Mr. Srinivasulu. Thank you, Soumya. Anjali, thank you. And Mr. Gaurav Gupta has left. And I thank all our colleagues for having put this together at very short notice. I will report back to you in a couple of hours, and we will trouble you in the coming weeks. And by the end of the series, hopefully we'll have a document which all of you will be proud of. So thank you. Thank you,
Bhargavi. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Leo, sir. Thank you so much, Bhargavi, ma'am, ESG, and of course, all the panelists. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.